for mathematicians, so, and I see there are many physicists in the audience, so the first part may be too elementary for them, because I'm going to start with quantum mechanics and things like that. So let me just, what I want to convey to you is why is this, first of all, this looks like a rather interesting and amazing connection. You might think, you know, quantum black holes and number theory, and both are kind of sexy words, but what do they have to do with each other? So that's the purpose of my, I don't want to give you all the details, so I just need to tell you a few things about string theory. So for the mathematicians in the audience, basically the main principles of quantum mechanics is that physical systems correspond to state, which physicists usually denote as a ket, but you can think of it as a vector. So I'm just going to give you a translation. A state is a vector in a Hilbert space. Then there are observables. So what is a physical system? For example, an electron. Electron with some momentum. An electron, a particle, elementary particle going in that direction. That's a state. It's in some state. It has some charge. It has some momentum. But I'm just going to give an abstract definition of what is a state and what is an electron. So observables are operators. Let's call them like P or A. So these are operators, self-adjoint operators usually. Then we have symmetries. Another important thing in physics is symmetry, so which is just some group G. And you have unitary irreducible representations of that symmetry acting on this Hilbert space. And then physicists often talk about quantum numbers, like mass of the particle or the angular momentum of the particle or the charge of the particle. And what you should understand is these are just eigenvalues of these operators. So you have some charge operator, and the charge operator can have eigenvalue plus 1, minus 1, plus 2, minus 2, and that's what we mean by a charge, by the quantum number of that particle. So for example, electron is a state with mass m, which is some number which you don't need to know, and it can have spin j3 in the plus minus half, and in some units its charge is 1. Minus 1. Okay, so that's what you mean by a state. And in particular, one of the important symmetric groups, so G is, so first of all, we live in a 4D space-time. So R3, 1. So it's like R4, but with the metric is not Euclidean, so it's a Lorentzian metric. And the transformation which leave this metric invariant are so-called the Poincaré group, which you can think of as ISO1, 3. It's an inhomogeneous group of rotations in an indefinite metric Hilbert vector space. And you can have G to be some, so therefore G is going to be ISO 1, 3 for sure. And then it can have some additional factors like U1 or SU2 and so on. So let's forget about the SU2 part, we'll just focus on these two things. So now I can give an abstract definition of what is a particle. A particle for a mathematician is just a unitary irreducible representation of this group G. In our case, just ISO 1, 3 cross U1. Okay, is that clear? So please feel free to ask questions. It's supposed to be a basics notion seminar. And so if you have even a trivial question, don't hesitate to ask. Huh? So electron, U1 is minus 1. And this has a Casimir. So it has the generators of this are the momentum generators, P, and rotations. So translations and rotations are the generators of this. And if you just look at the representation theory of this group, you'll find that it has one of the Casimirs is P square. It's a Casimir, it's a quadratic Casimir. So if P mu is the translation generator, if the group of translations is generated by P mu, then P square has to be is a Casimir invariant of this group. So the representations are labeled by this. So that is M. So M is some number. And then there is this Wigner's theory of little group representation. So you have to, in addition, have representations of little group of this. So for example, if you, momentum can be, let's call it energy. You can go to the rest frame of the electron. And then what leaves this invariant are a group of, so this is your time coordinate, this if you like, and this, these are the space coordinates. So you can go to the rest frame of the electron, this just has energy, which is equal to the mass. And then the little group, which leaves this invariant, is group of rotations SO3, whose representation theory you know very well. And that is the J, which in the case of the electron can only be plus or minus half. So it's just representation theory. So it's completely explicit. So you might not be familiar with the representation theory of Poincaré group, but you're certainly familiar with representation theory of SO3 and U1. And momentum is some additional thing because it's a non-compact group. So that you just take it from me. So any other question? Okay, so the next thing is general relativity. So that summarizes quantum mechanics, okay? So in general relativity, one of the very deep insights of ours in the last century was this principle of equivalence. And the basic idea was to just turn this manifold, which is R3, 1, into a curved manifold. And that's supposed to account for gravity. So gravity was somehow not to be regarded as some force, but it just came from curvature of space-time. So now you have a M, so a four-dimensional, it's pseudo, because it has this kind of a, but think of it as a Riemannian manifold. Okay, I will also add gauge theory. And then the metric eta goes to a curved general metric on this manifold. And ISO 1,3 goes over to the diffeomorphism of this manifold. So that's the symmetry. And I don't know, so presumably you're familiar with, I mean, I'm using sort of a mathematician's terminology. So gravity is given by connection. There's a connection on this manifold and curvature form. And the U1 goes to the electromagnetism, gauge theory, which for mathematicians is just a U1 bundle over M. Is that translation good enough for mathematicians in the audience? I mean, so do you understand, right? Sorry? What is even? So you imagine some arbitrary connection, arbitrary metric, and arbitrary curvature, general, totally general, a priori. Yeah, given a connection, you can compute it. Yeah. So omega is some d omega plus whatever it is, no, omega wedge omega or something. Yeah, so the given thing is just metric and connection. So given thing is manifold, metric, and connection. And the U1 bundle also has a U1 connection. So basically, that is a summary of Maxwell theory. This is Maxwell-Einstein theory. This is the summary of Maxwell-Einstein theory. Okay. But in physics, we have actions, you know. So we need, how is the dynamics of this to be determined? I mean, the connection is determined by some least action principle. And it is the least action principle. So you take the Riemann scalar, sorry, Ricci scalar. And square root of G minus S star F, I mean, where F is equal to and I suppose everybody knows what is the Riemann curvature, right? Sorry? It's an integral over d4x. Okay, here it's a bit awkward to write it in this language, but okay. Let me write it like this. So the metric defines a measure on the manifold, and you integrate using that measure. A scalar and another scalar constructed from the Riemannian, from the gauge bundle, the gauge curvature form. And delta I equal to 0 is a variational principle. You just vary this. Gives you second order nonlinear differential equations. And that determine so roughly speaking, the problem in physics is to, classical physics was to solve these equations. For example, one of the equations is d star f equal to 0. Bianchi identity is df equal to 0 for the connection. These are some of the equations that follow. And you have to solve for A for such equations. And the amazing fact of 19th century physics was that all of light, electricity, magnetism, this follows from these two equations. Because light are just some wave, this is a, gives you a wave equation, and light is just some wave-like solutions of these equations of arbitrary frequency, and that's the light. That gives you light. So even though they look very simple, they contain an enormous amount of physics. Einstein's equations are actually much harder to solve, because they are nonlinear, and they have much more interesting physics, which I'm going to tell you. So is this clear so far? U1. So I'm going to, so far, did I say the U1 bundle? So you have a manifold with a metric, a connection, and a U1 bundle. That's our setup. Is that clear? No, so for example here, one of the solutions would be A is equal to e to the I k dot x. We'll solve this. That's a light wave going at a momentum with some frequency. So one of the solutions, e to the minus I omega t plus e to the I k dot x. So this represents light plus its complex conjugate. This represents a light wave of frequency omega and wave moment, this is called a wave, wavelength 1 upon k. Yeah, so think of this as an action of GWA, and then you vary it. It turns out, okay, I'm simplifying a bit actually. It turns out that the, okay, let's proceed for the moment. I can answer this one. Is this clear? So this is actually unquantum. So quantum mechanics has been hugely successful in describing everything that we see, from laser pointers and all kinds of things, and atoms and everything. And this has been hugely successful for describing all kinds of phenomena. But the big puzzle was that when you try to put these two things together, when you try to marry them, there is a big problem. So that's the motivation for what I'm going to tell you today. So that's the setup. So is this clear what the problem is? Well, I mean, so these are really the two pillars of 20th century physics: general relativity and quantum mechanics, and gauge theories. And this, between these, we understand really everything pretty much that we see, from expansion of the universe, galaxies, solar systems. Everything comes from this variational principle. And light, and from quantum mechanics, you can understand atoms and everything, quarks. Of course, I have to, really doing the quantum mechanics is not a trivial thing, but I'm just saying that these principles are sufficient for us to understand phenomena going all the way from very small to very large. But there is a big problem, that these two theories are very fundamentally inconsistent with each other. And the, roughly to tell you, it's like, so in particular, Einstein's theory of gravity, in particular, Einstein's equation gives you also Newton's law of gravity. And if you, roughly the problem is that if you compute, for example, the Earth-Sun gravitational attraction, you know that the force between them, do you remember your Newton's laws? The mass of the Sun times mass of the Earth divided by the distance between the two. That's the force between the... Now we expect, this is classical, okay? This is classical, okay? Now you expect that if you include quantum effects, you'll get some small correction. But if you actually try to compute the quantum correction, what you find, the answer is infinite. So this is clearly wrong, because if you take general relativity and try to compute the simplest thing, like the force between two particles, then you get an infinite answer. And this is called the famous problem of non-renormalizability of gravity. This is a technical word for it. But the main thing is that if you compute a quantum correction to even the simplest processes, which you think, because it's a small correction, quantum correction to some small correction to some classical effect, it should be small, but instead of that, you get it to be infinite. And how to make sense of this, how to get rid of this contradiction, is the big problem in physics. So unlike in mathematics, when you say that if there is a contradiction, you would say that there is something, you just throw this thing away. In physics, what it says that that's actually an opportunity, because that means that each formalism is incomplete, and you're trying to find, you need to find a bigger framework in which they are not contradictory anymore. And this has been a very time-honored and very successful strategy in the past. Like, there was contradiction between Newton's laws and Maxwell's equations, and that's what led to special relativity and so on. Okay, so is that clear? Now I'm going to pass on to the transparencies. So one of the enduring challenges, so I hope I have convinced you that one of the enduring challenges of theoretical physics is to find a consistent framework for quantum gravity that unifies general relativity with quantum mechanics. And string theory has been one of the most promising routes towards such a quantum theory of gravity. And it has many things going for it, that it is what we call this problem that I told you, this infinity goes away if you do in string theory computation. You will get a finite answer, as you would expect. So it is perturbatively finite. Then there were all kinds of amazing dualities which were discovered, which tell you how to relate, so that you don't need to know. Then there is something called holography. So there is structurally, many serious physicists were kind of convinced that there is something really deep going on in the structure of string theory. However, there is a big however. that if we don't have the string theory somehow, all these effects become important at very high energy scale. And we don't have a super LHC. We are already run out of money with LHC to probe the theory directly at the Planck scale. In fact, we don't even know which phase of the theory. So phase meaning, for example, for water, water can exist either as vapor or as liquid. And depending on whether it's liquid or vapor, its properties are different. And so before you can make predictions, you need to know which is the phase of the matter that you're considering. And string theory lives in 10 dimensions. And we don't know which phase corresponds to the real world. So given this fact, how can we be sure that string theory is the right approach to quantum gravity in the absence of direct experiments? I mean, unless you are religious fanatics. So how do we proceed? And one kind of a strategy is to focus on universal features that must hold in all phases of the theory. So if you can think of some quantity, like in the case of water, which holds true even in whether you are considering water as liquid or water as vapor, then you have some hope of getting some universal. And entropy of a black hole is one such quantity, which gives very precise and quantitative thermodynamic information. And the main principle is that in quantum gravity, it should be possible to interpret the black hole as an ensemble of states in the Hilbert space of the theory. So I have told you, in quantum mechanics, each state is represented by, each physical system is represented by a state. But as we will see, a black hole is not a single state, but it's a collection of states. It's an ensemble of states. And how to describe that? Therefore, there is a Hilbert subspace corresponding to each black hole. So I have to tell you what is a black hole, and what is an ensemble, and so on, and what is entropy. So that is the purpose of my next 20 minutes. But I just want to give you some historical analogy, because I don't think I can explain it. It's something that you might have seen in high school physics, is that in the absence of microscope, one can often learn a lot about the microstructure from the thermodynamic properties. So you probably vaguely remember something called thermodynamics, entropy, second law of thermodynamics. So for example, some of the far-seeing physicists of the 19th century, you know, as early as, say, 1860, had foreseen many essential features of quantum physics well before the final formulation of quantum theory, which came some 80 or 90 years later. Things like identical particles have to satisfy some particular statistics. They have to be treated. How do you count them? This is some n factorial. It's called Gibbs paradox. To really understand it in quantum theory requires spin statistics theorem and all kinds of things, which require really relativistic quantum field theory, which came many years later. But just from thermodynamic considerations, you could at least see that there was a problem even if you couldn't solve it. And our sort of, we will try to follow in the footsteps of these masters, like Maxwell and Gibbs and Boltzmann, to use the quantum properties of black hole in an analogous fashion. And in this search, you actually are led to number theory, as I'm going to explain to you. And it will become clear to you why. So I'm just going to give a simple historical analogy. See, what is known as kinetic theory of gases is something that you learn in undergraduate physics. But this was really a triumph of 19th century physics, and it formed the basis for the atomic hypothesis and later for quantum theory. And it started, you know, with attempts to explain macroscopic properties of ideal gases in terms of microscopic atoms, even though there were no microscopes at the time that could actually see or establish the reality of atoms directly. In fact, Boltzmann is associated with 3SD, I think, and he committed suicide because nobody took him seriously, the atomic hypothesis. And one of the fundamental concepts that makes this possible, so what is kinetic theory of gases? That, you know, our room is full of some gas that we all believe is full of atoms of nitrogen. I mean, all of you believe, but now, why do you believe in that? You've never seen one, right? How do we know that this room is really full of atoms? And if you don't have a microscope like the LHC, how can you even make such a ridiculous assertion that it's really composed of little atoms? But that's what Maxwell and Boltzmann did. And what led them there was actually very practical considerations trying to design efficient steam engines, because that was the time when the Industrial Revolution was happening. So One of the things that we know, that heat flows from a hot body to a cold body, but not the other way around. So how can you quantify this irreversibility? And that led to the notion of entropy, that you define a quantity called entropy. If you add some heat delta Q to a body at temperature T, then you say that its entropy changes in this manner. Delta change in the entropy is equal to the heat that you add to it divided by the temperature. Right? So you take a bucket of water and you heat it. And you know, you just keep track of how much heat you are giving to the bucket of water. And if you keep the temperature fixed, then that's the definition. And you can do it infinitesimally. So you can. And then the second law of thermodynamics, which was formulated by Carnot, who was incidentally an engineer, he was not a physicist. He said that, but this led to a very important concept in physics, that in an irreversible process, the net entropy always increases. So delta S has to be greater than zero. And entropy is an intrinsic property of a given system and is a function of the energy and the volume of the system. So S is a function of volume and the total energy. So like in this room is full of gas, nitrogen, let's say. And the volume of this room we know, and the temperature and the total energy in this room we know. And that tells you what is the entropy of this nitrogen gas. So that is the assertion. And then, if you now do anything to this system, regarding this as a closed system, that you put a heater here or whatever you do, in an irreversible process, the net entropy has to always increase. And how does that explain this, our initial question, that heat flows from a hot body to a net body? Suppose you have now a hot body, which you bring in contact with a cold body, then the delta Q flows from a body at temperature T1 to a body at temperature T2, then the net change in entropy is the total delta Q divided by 1 upon T2, because this lower temperature guy gained entropy, and the higher temperature body lost entropy. So the net change in entropy is delta Q, absolute value, 1 upon T2 minus 1 upon T1. And second law of thermodynamics requires that delta S has to be greater than 0. So therefore, heat can only flow if T1 is bigger than T2. So is this clear? This is the second law of thermodynamics. Then comes in Boltzmann, and he made this really one of the more subtle and deep concepts in physics. It's a little harder to understand because it's not an eigenvalue of an operator, the entropy, like charge or momentum, as I described. He said that this entropy that you define in this macroscopic way is proportional to, with some constant, the logarithm of the total number of microstates in which this whole system can exist. So for example, this whole system, some of the atoms can be in one corner, or some of the atoms can be here. Atoms can be moving all over the place. So there are many ways I can organize all these atoms in this room. And that gives me, that is equal to the entropy of this. And as I said, it's really one of the more subtle and deep concepts, because it gives you information not about an eigenvalue of some one operator, but about the dimension of a Hilbert subspace. Now, we are used to using Hilbert subspaces, but this was in 1860, when the notion of a Hilbert space and quantization was not even on the horizon. Okay, perhaps I can skip this disorder. So for our purposes, the significance of entropy stems from the fact that one can draw important conclusions about the microscopic structure of an object and the relevant degrees of freedom from its gross thermodynamic microscopic properties. So entropy, therefore, is a window into the microstructure of the system. So even though you cannot see the atoms in this room, you can actually deduce the properties of atoms by measuring the entropy, or how the entropy changes when you heat the room. And it's a very simple calculation. Again, you can do it on an envelope. I will do it in front of you, in front of your eyes. So imagine this room is full of nitrogen gas. And imagine there are n molecules in this room. And the typical size of the molecule, let's say, is lambda. So therefore, this room, the total volume of this room has to divide up. You cannot see this, okay, but it's divided up. Can you see? There is this blue box, which is the room, and it is divided up into so many little boxes. So this is the room, and it has n molecules, and you just divide up, of each of length lambda, and n of them. And so now this is a combinatorics problem, right? Given n atoms, so number of boxes is therefore, it's a totally simple combinatorics problem. The total number of ways you can put so many molecules n, arrange these molecules in the room, the number of ways you can arrange n molecules in this room of size V is the number of boxes available to you to the power n, because if it's dilute, you can put them, you can put it here to the power n. And if they're identical particles, you have to divide by 1 upon n factorial. It's like a statistics, quantum, just a regular combinatorial statistics. So it's a completely trivial calculation, right? You can, anybody can do this. But this is actually one of the very, very important computations of the 19th century physics. Because if you put the right value of lambda, which is called the thermal wavelength of this, sorry, it should not be de Broglie, it's the thermal wavelength, which depends on temperature, then you get the right answer for the entropy. Namely, this very trivial looking calculation, if you take the logarithm of that, and if you put lambda, correct lambda, then that gives you the correct answer for the entropy experimentally. Meaning if you now hit this room, and then what you will find is that the change in entropy will be given because lambda changes when you heat the room and the temperature goes up. And precisely in this manner. So the microscopic counting that we did here in a very simple way explains a macroscopic entropy. So this is a very basic thing that I want you to understand for the mathematicians in the audience. Is this clear? Why entropy is so fundamental in physics? Questions? I mean, I'm sure all of you have seen this in undergraduate physics, but perhaps not in a manner that emphasizes the significance of it. But I should say that it's really, one can give, three lectures on entropy. And it's really one of the, so now, is this clear why entropy is important? Now I'm going to tell you about black holes. A black hole is a space-time, is one of the solutions of Einstein's equation. I've probably written it here somewhere. It's a solution of Einstein's equation. A black hole is a solution of Einstein equations. And in the simplest case, it's a Ricci flat manifold. The Ricci curvature of the manifold is zero. It's a pseudo-Riemannian manifold, and it has a Ricci curvature. So in the simplest case, which is called the Schwarzschild black hole, it's just a Ricci flat manifold in four dimensions with a pseudo, with a metric of this indefinite signature. So that's a black hole. Okay, it's just a solution of a second order nonlinear differential equation. Is this clear? And it is specified also much like an electron by mass, charge, and spin. Okay? Even though it's a solution of this very complicated equation, it turns out in the end, it is specified just by mass, charge, and spin. And there is a singularity, but it's clothed by an event horizon. So this is an artist's impression of a black hole. And the fundamental fact about a black hole is that it is surrounded by an event horizon. And what is an event horizon? So this is the kind of thing that mathematicians don't encounter, because if you're doing Riemannian manifolds, you never will encounter such a thing. It's really crucial. Lot of the interesting stuff that happens here in physics has to do with the fact that time behaves differently from space. For example, a wave equation. I mean, see, this is the solution of the wave equation. The wave equation, I mean, elliptic operator and a hyperbolic operator are very different. So this is a hyperbolic operator. Whereas normally in mathematics, you are in a much safer territory when you deal with elliptic operators, like just with a plus sign. And that makes all the difference, because such a thing is not a solution of, except for k equal to zero. So even a photon wave would not be possible if you were just dealing with elliptic operators. An event horizon is possible precisely because you have a hyperbolic because of the minus sign. And basically, event horizon is a one-way surface from behind which you cannot come out, but will surely meet a singularity where tidal forces are infinite. Okay, that's the definition of a black hole. Meaning, it's like this room, you know. You can only come inside, but once you come to my lecture, you cannot go out. You're forbidden to go out. So that's, it's a, like a one-way surface. You can only come in, but you cannot go out. Now, a black hole is at once the most simple and yet the most complex object. And understanding the simplicity is in the realm of classical gravity. And understanding the complexity is in the realm of quantum gravity. So what do I mean by that? So actually, last year I had the opportunity to go to this Kerr conference. You know, Kerr was a famous, he discovered one of the most famous solutions of Einstein's equations. And it was in his honor, 50 years of the Kerr solution. And there was a very beautiful quote of Chandrasekhar, one of the famous astrophysicists from India, who said that one of his most shattering experiences in life was to realize that the Kerr solution, which was the solution of this equation, describes every possible black hole that we see exactly. It's an exact solution because of what is called the no-hair theorem. That means a black hole is completely specified by mass, spin, and charge, very much like an elementary particle. And this is a tremendous simplicity. You know, for example, if I look at the table and try to look at the gravitational field of a table or of the sun, it's very, very complicated because the sun can have bulges, it can have mountains and valleys, and the gravitational field is not specified just by the mass and the charge. You have to know how the mass is distributed. So it depends on the what are called the higher moments, dipole moment, quadrupole moments, and so on. Not for a black hole. For a black hole, you just specify the mass, charge, and spin. And everything is specified. You just have one solution, you just write it down, and that's the description of a black hole. Unlike for the sun, where you have to do, you really need a lot more information about various properties of the sun. And the event horizon, as I told you, is this one-way surface. So the simplicity is very easy, that a black hole, for some reason, a very complicated solution of this nonlinear differential equations, is specified by just three parameters, very much like an elementary particle. So for a while, people thought maybe a black hole is an elementary particle. But it turns out that it's actually not an elementary particle, but it's more like a collection of, it's an ensemble of states, of elementary particle-like states. But now I'm going to, so how much time? I have 20 minutes. And am I allowed to go a bit over time or? Okay. So depending on that, okay, so let me, maybe I'll go 5 to 10 minutes over time. So I'm just going to run you through some paradoxes based on what I have told you so far. And then that leads us to number theory, how that happens. So as I told you now, a classical black hole has this one-way surface. Now, Bekenstein, who was then a graduate student in Princeton of Wheeler, he asked this very simple-minded question, that what happens if you throw a bucket of hot water into a black hole? Because I have just told you, it can only come inside and cannot go out. But then, a bucket of hot water, as I told you, has entropy. So therefore, the entropy, as far as the outside world is concerned, which can never look inside the black hole, has decreased. But I just told you, the second law of thermodynamics says that the entropy has to always increase. So Bekenstein said that the second law of thermodynamics, which is so fundamental, and I told you entropy is such a big thing, seems to be violated if there are black holes present, because you can just dump in as much entropy as you like, and you will decrease the entropy around the world. So then he said, well, but maybe the black hole also has entropy. And then what you should really keep track of is the entropy of the black hole. And the, I mean, after all, if you drop a hot water in sun, you don't worry about the second law of thermodynamics because the entropy of the sun goes up. And you keep track of everything, you find that entropy actually decreases, increases and doesn't decrease. So he said that, okay, the black hole must have entropy, such that second law is saved. And he gave some very specific prediction for what the entropy should be. But that leads to another paradox. Because if black hole has entropy and mass, then there is a first law of thermodynamics which relates the change in energy is temperature times the change in energy of a system is temperature times change in entropy. So in the case of black hole is the mass. So if the black hole has mass and it has entropy, then it must have temperature. But you know that everything, anything that is hot is always radiating something. Therefore, something should come out from the black hole. But that's a paradox because, as I told you, nothing can come outside of a black hole because the event horizon means that things can fall in that cannot come out. So this led to a second paradox. So I'm just trying to tell you that just follow the way 19th century physicists reasoned about the atomic world without knowing what were the atomic constituents of matter, they could actually go very far. In some similar way, physicists in 20th century have been able to reason about properties of space-time and quantum gravity, even without knowing what are the precise rules. We still don't know. We don't have a complete theory. So this is the famous discovery of Hawking in the 1970s, that actually the black hole, even though classically it has this event horizon, there is a little quantum fluctuation happening at the horizon. And therefore, sometimes, and there is always this pair creation, as you might have heard about. And one of the pairs can escape, and one pair falls inside. So it can look like the black hole radiates. In fact, Hawking therefore found that the black hole has temperature precisely in a way that the first law of thermodynamics is satisfied, and the second law of thermodynamics is saved in the manner that Bekenstein had proposed it. So this led to the picture of what you call semi-classical black hole, in that it's not fully classical. You have to take some quantum effects into account to understand that it has temperature. But once you do that, then Hawking gave this very beautiful, this is a precise formula for the entropy of the black hole. That you have a horizon of the black hole. So black hole is, as I told you, is just a surface. It's an S2 in R3. Time is flowing. And it has some radius, so you can calculate its area. It's 4 pi times standard formula from Euclidean geometry. And that area times c is the speed of light, h bar is Planck's constant, g is Newton's constant. And there is 4. So entropy is always area divided by 4. It's a very beautiful formula. Take any black hole that you like, of any mass, any charge. This is true in any dimension. You do a 5-dimensional black hole, 4-dimensional, it doesn't matter. So there is something really deep and universal about this. And now this means that the black hole has huge entropy. But that leads to the third paradox. So L is just, I can therefore, just by dimensional analysis, S has no dimensions. Area is like length square. So it must be, this is called the Planck length. Basically, h bar g divided by c cube, I can write as L square. So that the whole quantity is dimensionless. Because to compare with Boltzmann, we have to compare with log of some number. So the paradox theory is that if a black hole has entropy, then in quantum theory it must be an ensemble of microstates, according to Boltzmann. But then a black hole, by definition, so it's called black hole because it's literally a hole in space-time. And it's black because another way to think about the event horizon is that, as you know, there is an escape velocity for a rocket. You have to, if you throw something up, it always falls down. But if you go at the speed of rocket, then you can escape the gravitational field of Earth. But if your escape velocity is the speed of light, then you know that nothing can travel faster than the speed of light. And therefore, nothing can escape the black hole. So that's another way to think about the event horizon. Event horizon is that the escape velocity becomes equal to the speed of light. So therefore, it's literally a hole in space from which nothing can come out. And how can you associate some states? I mean, in the case of gas in this room, we imagined that there were little point particles, you know, little atoms floating around, and we put them in some box, and that's how we counted the number of states. And to resolve this paradox, we really need a full-fledged quantum theory of gravity with some well-defined quantum Hilbert space. And that's where string theory comes into picture, because basically that is our only candidate at the moment, which has a properly defined Hilbert space where you can actually say that, a black hole can be a state like that. So now I come to the first part of the title of my talk, that quantum black holes. A black hole is simple not because it is like an elementary particle, but rather because it is like a thermodynamic ensemble. And this explains why it is both simple and complex. And I will explain this in a moment. So basically, what do I mean by a thermodynamic ensemble? So I told you, a state is specified by some quantum numbers, like m and j. But for example, I can have many states which have the same quantum numbers. For example, if I say that my total mass, like in this room, the total energy is some fixed. But I can construct, have so much energy because one particle is going that way and another particle is going that way, or two particles are going in that way. They will all have the same amount of energy. Or for example, if I say that I have 10 times the mass of the, my total mass is equal to the 10 times the mass of the electron. Then I can have those many, one electron sitting here, another electron sitting there. All these states will have the same mass, namely 10. So therefore, you can also have an ensemble of states in a Hilbert space. It's simply a subspace with fixed eigenvalues of some operator. Some observables, which I said are operators. So I can say that, for example, I want q is equal to some number, minus 100, let's say, and j is equal to some number, 256, right? And I can say m is equal to, in some units, some number. And then all that I need to do, so log omega that I introduce in Boltzmann relation, as a function of this mass, charge, and j, is equal to the dimension of this. Let me call this some subspace H, sorry, omega is just the dimension of this. Is this clear? Omega, which was the total number of states, so in Boltzmann relation, so this is an important thing. So if you understand this, then you will understand. You will go away with something. So you remember Boltzmann relation was log omega. What is this omega? Omega is the total number of states. But now I can be more precise since you know quantum mechanics. That by states, I mean the total number of the dimension of the Hilbert space with some specified values for the operators under consideration. So if I take the total Hilbert space and look at the subspace where mass has some value, q has some value, j has some value, these are usually finite dimensional, and you just count the dimension of that operator, of that Hilbert space, and that is omega. And the fundamental and a very beautiful relation of Boltzmann tells you that that microscopic counting is related to this macroscopic. Right? Here you're talking about atoms. Or, you know, and here you're talking about like a gas and so on, right? Properties of steam engines, right? And roughly speaking, general relativity is on this side and quantum mechanics is on this side. And a black hole is on this side, which is the analog of a steam engine. And the question is, what are the atoms that make up the black hole? So that is the question that string theory has been able to answer in a rather surprising detail for a simple set of relatively simple systems. But as I said, because this requirement is so fundamental and is universal, if, for example, we had failed to do it, even for the simplest black hole, then we could just forget about string theory. We would know that string theory is wrong. So even without doing an experiment, you would be able to just... So it's extremely non-trivial that actually string theory is able to account for black hole as an ensemble of states. So which ensemble of states? And can you make some computations? And then area upon 4 should be given by log of this omega, of this ensemble. Is that clear? So this is the basic setup, because of which now you can see very quickly where number theory comes in. I should say number theory is here. Because in this case we did some very counting problem, right? This was a counting problem, right? This was combinatorics. So basically, counting the microsets of black holes leads to a much more sophisticated and hard counting problem. And it's a combinatorics. So now I will switch to blackboard a little bit. So combinatorics and number theory. So as I told you, in string theory now we understand a black hole is related to some ensemble of states. And in the simplest example, it's an ensemble of some very simple states. Okay, I'll give you a simple example. It's an ensemble of state of a string oscillating in 24 dimensions. Okay, so string-like object oscillating transverse 24 dimensions. Okay, this is related to the fact that we live in, string theory lives in 8 dimensions, and there is another group called E8 cross E8, so there is some story there. But basically you have, this is the counting problem, that you have a string-like object oscillating in 24 dimensions. How many ways can it oscillate? It can oscillate this way, it cannot oscillate that way, and you have to think of some, there is a counting problem that you have to do, and you have to quantize this system. But it basically reduces to partitions of an integer and for a given total energy. The total energy is fixed. So you cannot, given fixed total energy, you have to count. This reduces to a problem of partitions of an integer. Using 24 colors. So for example, let me give you, and this is actually a well-known object in combinatorial number theory. I don't know, going back to Ramanujan and many people like that. So this is denoted by P24N. How do you calculate it? So let me compute for you P of N, just P1 of, or a P3 of 5. So how many ways can I write 5? Okay, let me do a simpler one, P3 of 3. So I can write 3 equal to, I can write it as 1 plus 1 plus 1 with a blue chalk, or 1 plus 1 plus 1 with a yellow chalk, or 1 plus 1 plus 1 with a white chalk. But I can also write with a 2 in white and 1 in yellow, right? I can have all these combinations. 2 in white, plus. You can count them, right? This is trivial, I mean, not trivial, it's actually a non-trivial computation. And that number, so instead of using now 3 colors, you use 24 colors. And for any given integer n, and that's related to entropy of a black hole of a certain, it turns out that this quantity is related, is equal to the omega for some set of black holes. Okay? But this actually gives one of the most beautiful instead of computing these P24s of N,